Good afternoon, one and all. Welcome back to another session of Learn from the Masters. For today's session, we'll have a session on fundus florus and angiography, which will be taken by Dr. Pradeep Sagar, who's our consultant in the Department of Vitreoretina at Shimoga. Over to you, Dr. Sagar.
Good afternoon, all. I'm Dr. Pradeep. I would like to thank Dr. Saptagiri sir for giving me this opportunity. Today I'll be discussing about fundus florus in angiography. Fundus florus in angiography is a very important diagnostic tool in diagnosis and management of retinal and choroidal disorders. It's a vast topic to cover in a single class, so I would be restricting myself to use of appropriate angiographic terminologies. What do we see in a normal fluorescein angiography? And we will discuss a few clinical entities that we come across in a day-to-day practice. I would recommend everyone to use a laptop or a desktop, because the images are like we would see at least two or three images in one slide. So a higher zoom would be adequate. When it comes to fundus florescein angiography, we use these two terminology to describe most of our lesions. One is hyperfluorescence and the other is hypofluorescence. You may have to be very specific when you hear these terms, because they usually sound very similar, but I will try to emphasize, but still you may have to be very keen in hearing this. One is hyperfluorescence and one is hypofluorescence. When it comes to hyperfluorescence, it can be either due to presence of more dye. That is, the particular tissue we are seeing may have higher concentration of dye. It can be classified as leak, pooling, or staining. Or it can be due to a better visibility of the normal concentration of the dye itself, when we call it a window defect. Coming to hypofluorescence, in the same way, it can be due to either lesser concentration of the dye in the tissue, which is due to a non-perfusion, also known as vascular filling defect, or it could be due to poor visibility of the dye, which is called the block fluorescence. So coming to the leak. So leak is characterized by increase in intensity of hyperfluorescence over time and increase in size of hyperfluorescence over time. So here we can see that there is a area of hyperfluorescence which is very tiny, whereas as the time progresses, we see that there is an increase in size as well as the intensity of hyperfluorescence. This usually indicates that either there would be a new vessel with a poor blood retinal barrier, which is allowing the dye to extravasate into the tissue, or it would be secondary to a disruption of a blood retinal barrier, either due to an inflammation or a structural damage. The fluorescein dye usually is localized to the retinal and the choroidal vessels, and it doesn't leak into the tissue except for the choriocapillaries. So if we see that there is increase in size of the hyperfluorescence, it indicates that the dye has leaked into the tissue. Pooling. Pooling is characterized by increase in intensity of hyperfluorescence over time, whereas the size remains constant. Here we can see the size of the hyperfluorescence is almost similar, whereas the intensity has significantly increased in the late phase. It usually indicates leak of dye into a well-defined space, such as a pigment epithelial detachment or a neurosensory detachment. Staining. Staining is also characterized by increase in intensity of hyperfluorescence over time and the size remains constant. For example, here we can see that this is the edge of the optic nerve head. The edge of the optic nerve head shows an increase in intensity of hyperfluorescence, whereas the size is similar. This is almost similar to pooling, but we call it staining when the leak of dye is into a tissue rather than a space. Tissues which show staining include sclera, choroid, or drusen and chorioretinal scars. Window defect. Window defect is characterized by increase in intensity of hyperfluorescence initially, followed by decrease in intensity of hyperfluorescence as the time progresses, whereas the size remains constant. Here we can see the intensity of the hyperfluorescence increased initially, later it reduced, but the size of the hyperfluorescence is constant. It indicates loss of retinal layers or retinal pigment epithelium, so that we can see the choroid more easily. For example, it can be due to a retinal hole or a RPE atrophy or geographic atrophy. So why this occurs is, usually in an angiogram, initially there is increase in concentration of dye in the retinal and choroidal vessels, and after around 30 seconds, the recirculation starts and the concentration of the dye in the choroid and the retina decreases. That's why we see that the concentration of dye decreases and the intensity of the hyperfluorescence also decreases. Coming to hypofluorescence, it can be a block fluorescence. Block fluorescence indicates that there is a presence of a certain substance which is obscuring the normal underlying fluorescence. There are two subtypes, one in which only the choroidal fluorescence is blocked. For example, here we can see that there is an altered subretinal hemorrhage, which is seen as a white structure over here, and the corresponding angiography shows hypofluorescence. We are not seeing the underlying choroidal fluorescence, but we can see the overlaying retinal vessels and fluorescence from the retinal vessels. So block fluorescence help us to identify the relative location of the structure which is leading to block fluorescence. So this is the other type in which both the choroidal and retinal fluorescence are blocked. Here we can see that there is extensive superficial retinal hemorrhages, and the corresponding angiography shows hypofluorescence in which both the retinal vessels as well as the choroidal fluorescence is blocked. So how to differentiate the two is, in cases in which only the choroidal fluorescence is blocked, we will be able to see the retinal vasculature, and it is due to a structure which is located deeper in the deeper layers of the retina or in the subretinal space. Whereas if we are not seeing both the retinal and choroidal fluorescence, it means that there is a structure which is in the superficial retinal layers or in the preretinal space. Coming to the other type, that is hypofluorescence due to presence of less dye in the tissue. It is called non-perfusion or vascular filling defect. Here we can see that there is extensive areas of hypofluorescence, and the corresponding fundus photo doesn't show any structure which would obscure the fluorescence. So this is due to decrease in the concentration of dye. It can occur either due to loss of circulation or due to absence of capillaries or complete occlusion of capillaries. So how to differentiate a non-perfusion and a block fluorescence? Both are seen as hypofluorescence. So the best way is, we have to see the corresponding fundus photograph. In cases with non-perfusion, we usually don't see a substance that can block the fluorescence on color photo. Whereas in cases with block fluorescence, we'll definitely see a structure which would be responsible for block fluorescence. So coming to the normal fundus fluorescence angiography, it is usually described in phases. The first phase is choroidal flush. The interval between the injection of dye and the appearance of dye in the choroidal circulation is called arm retina time. Usually it is around 10 to 12 seconds in young individuals, whereas it's around 12 to 15 seconds in older individuals. Choroidal flush is seen as a faint, irregular hyperfluorescence, we can see scattered islands of delayed filling even in normal individuals. Ciliary retinal artery is a branch of ciliary artery which supplies the retina. It is arising from the choroidal vessels, so it fills in the choroidal phase. It is seen in around 30% of population. The second phase is arterial phase. It is characterized by filling of retinal arteries, but the retinal veins still show hypofluorescence. It usually occurs at 1 to 3 seconds after the choroidal flush. The next phase is the arteriovenous phase, also called transit phase. This phase is characterized by filling of precapillary arterioles, capillaries, and postcapillary venules. This is also characterized by the presence of the laminar flow in the retinal veins. Here we can see that the postcapillary vein venules are completely filled, and here we can see that there is a laminar flow in the retinal veins. Laminar flow is characterized by presence of hypofluorescence in the center of the lumen, whereas the periphery of the lumen shows a lamina of hyperfluorescence. This is mainly because of two reasons. One is the center of the lumen usually contains blood from the retinal peripheries, which usually fills late. So we can see that the center of the blood vessel usually contains blood from the retinal periphery. For example, here we can see that here we can see the laminar flow, whereas here we are not seeing the laminar flow because here the circulation is not yet started. The second reason is the flow of blood vessel, the flow of blood in the retinal vessel is faster near the vessel wall. It is mainly because the center of the blood vessel usually contains cells and the flow is slower, whereas in the periphery it is filled with plasma and the flow is usually faster. So we see the laminar flow. Coming to the venous phase. In the venous phase, it's again subclassified as early venous and late venous. In the early venous phase, we see widening of laminar flow. As we can see in this diagram, the laminar flow has widened and the area of hypofluorescence in the center of the lumen has decreased in size. The late venous phase is characterized by complete fill of retinal venous tree, and in this phase we see a maximum retinal and choroidal fluorescence, which is roughly at 20 to 25 seconds. Because at this point of time, that's around 20 to 25 seconds of injection of dye, the concentration of dye in the retinal and choroidal vessels is maximum. After this, the recirculation starts and the concentration of the dye starts decreasing. That is the recirculation phase, which is usually beyond 30 seconds, in which the concentration of dye within the retinal and choroidal vessels start decreasing and the fluorescence is completely washed out of the retinal and choroidal vessels by around 10 minutes. There are a few things which we have to see in every fundus fluorescein angiographic images. One is the foveal avascular zone. Here we can see that it is seen as an area of hypofluorescence and it is best seen at 25 to 30 seconds. That is when the concentration of fluorescein in the retinal and choroidal vasculature is maximum. The hypofluorescence at this location is due to a few reasons. One is absence of retinal vasculature. So here we can see that the retinal vasculature ends over here and the center doesn't have any capillaries. The other reason is the retinal pigment epithelium at the fovea is tall and is rich in melanin. So it blocks the underlying choroidal fluorescence. Again, macular xanthophylls are present in the foveal and perifoveal area in the outer plexiform layer, which also blocks the underlying fluorescence. The other reason is the incident light in fluorescein angiography is blue, which is observed well by the yellow xanthophyll pigment. So the amount of light which can be reflected back is lesser in this area. Presence of a normal foveal avascular zone indicates good health of fovea. In normal fundus fluorescein angiogram, we also see staining of disc margin and lamina cribrosa in late phase. The dye usually leaves the retinal and choroidal circulation by around 10 minutes, whereas the dye which leaks through the fenestrated endothelial cell in the choreo capillaries stain the sclera and lamina cribrosa, which is seen as staining in late phase. So what to see in a fundus fluorescein angiogram? So first we have to note arm retina time, then we have to see choroidal filling, whether it's delayed or whether it's patchy. Then we have to see for arterial filling, whether it's normal or delayed. We have to see for venous filling. Then we have to talk about the foveal avascular zone, whether it's intact, whether it's intact or distorted or enlarged. Then we have to see other specific findings pertaining to individual disease. Irrespective of whatever clinical condition we are seeing, we have to concentrate on all these steps. Coming to the clinical conditions that we see in our day-to-day practice, first I will be discussing about the vascular disorders of retina and choroid. Ocular ischemic syndrome. Ocular ischemic syndrome is a disease process due to decrease in flow through the ophthalmic artery. So, as expected, we see a delay in both choroidal and retinal filling in such cases. We see patchy choroidal filling. As we can see over here, the choroidal filling is only seen in this particular area, whereas in the peripapillary area, superior to disc, nasal to disc, and inferior to cyst, we are not seeing any filling of choroid. And we can also see a leading edge of the dye in the retinal vessels. We rarely see leading edge of the dye in the retinal vessels if the circulation is normal. If the circulation through the retinal vessels is slow, then only we will be able to see the leading edge of the dye. So it can be seen in ocular ischemic syndrome as well as central retinal artery occlusion. The clinical utility of fluorescein angiography in this particular disease is confirmation of diagnosis. In some cases with neovascularization of iris, venous dilatation, mid-peripheral hemorrhages, we are pretty much sure that it would be an ocular ischemic syndrome, but it can be confirmed only with fluorescein angiography. Diabetic retinopathy. So in this particular slide, we can see that there is minimal distortion of foveal vascular zone. We can see that it's almost intact, whereas temporal to fovea, there are a few perifoveal microaneurysm. We can see multiple dot hyperfluorescence in arteriovenous phase, which are corresponding to the red dots on color photograph, which is suggestive of microaneurysm. And here we can see that there is block fluorescence due to cotton wool spot and due to hemorrhages. Here we can see that there is an increase in intensity and size of hyperfluorescence around microaneurysm in the late phase, which is suggestive of a leaky microaneurysm. We usually classify the macular edema angiographically as focal, diffuse, or mixed. If the edema is predominantly due to a focal leak from microaneurysm, it's called focal leak. Whereas if we can't explain leak due to microaneurysm alone, and if it is due to a diffuse incompetence of retinal capillaries, we call it as diffuse leak. In this case, more than 2/3 of the leak that we are seeing can be attributable to microaneurysm. As we can see over here, there's a higher concentration of microaneurysm, and it definitely explains the amount of leak we are seeing in this particular case. So it's a case of non-proliferative diabetic retinopathy with focal leak. So in this slide, we can see that again, the foveal vascular zone is slightly distorted. The shape is slightly altered, whereas the microaneurysms in the perifoveal area are less in number compared to the previous slide. But in the late frames, we can see that there is an increase in intensity and size of hyperfluorescence in the perifoveal area, which is suggestive of leak, and the leak shows a petal-like appearance. Here we can see that if we draw these, we can see that it's like a petal. So it's called petaloid appearance, and it is highly characteristic of cystoid macular edema. In this case, less than 1/3 of the edema or the leak can be attributable to microaneurysm. So it's called a diffuse leak. In this image, we can see that there is a significant distortion and enlargement of foveal vascular zone, which is suggestive of macular ischemia. And we can also see presence of perifoveal dot hyperfluorescence, which is suggestive of microaneurysm. Here we can see that there are areas of central hypofluorescence with rim of hyperfluorescence, which are due to chorioretinal scars due to laser photocoagulation. In chorioretinal scar due to laser, the center of the scar shows non-perfusion due to loss of choriocapillaries, whereas the edges of this scar shows staining. That's why we see it has a central hypofluorescence with a rim of hyperfluorescence. Here we can see that there is extensive areas of hypofluorescence due to non-perfusion. And here in this particular area, we see a vascular network which is interconnecting an artery and a vein, and it's not showing any leak. So it is suggestive of intraretinal microvascular abnormalities. Here we can see that there are a few perifoveal microaneurysm, and the foveal vascular zone is slightly distorted, and we can see that there is a blocked fluorescence due to preretinal hemorrhage. Here we can see that there is irregular network of vessels in the venous phase, which are spanning across the major vessels. Here we can see that it is crossing a major vessel. Here we can see that it's crossing a major vessel, and it's showing a profuse leak in late phase. So this is suggestive of a neovascularization elsewhere. Again, here we can see that there is perifoveal leak. And as I told, less than 1/3 of the leak is attributable to microaneurysms, as there are very few microaneurysms over here. So this is suggestive of a diffuse leak. So this is a case of proliferative diabetic retinopathy with preretinal hemorrhage with diffuse leak. So what are the indications of fluorescein angiography in diabetic retinopathy? Probably a decade ago, almost all cases of diabetic retinopathy used to be advised fluorescein angiography, but over time the use of fluorescein angiography has come down. But still, there are specific reasons why fluorescein angiography is still essential. One reason would be documentation. This is a universal indication. Any retinal or choroidal vascular disease, you can consider a fluorescein angiography for documentation and confirmation of your findings. The second most important thing would be in cases with unexplained poor vision. So in cases with unexplained poor vision in diabetic retinopathy, we have to rule out macular ischemia, which can be done by fluorescein angiography. Nowadays, OCTA is being used for identifying macular ischemia, but in those places where OCTA is not available, fluorescein angiography is a very good tool in identifying macular ischemia. Here we can see that there is a significant distortion and enlargement of the foveal vascular zone. So this patient would tend to have a lower visual acuity. Coming to macular edema, in the current era, macular edema, particularly the center involving macular edema, is predominantly treated with intravitreal anti-VEGF therapy. And when it comes to a treatment with intravitreal anti-VEGF therapy, the role of fluorescein angiography is not much. Whereas if we plan to treat macular edema with laser, we need to know the following things. One, we have to rule out macular ischemia. So we have to differentiate whether the macular edema is perfused or non-perfused. Here we can see that there is leak without significant areas of ischemia, whereas here we can see that there is extensive ischemia. So this is a perfused macular edema, whereas this is a non-perfused macular edema. When it's non-perfused, it is a contraindication for laser. The second reason is we have to identify whether it's a focal leak or a diffuse leak. As I already discussed, in this case, the microaneurysms are the reason for leak, so we call it focal leak. In this case, it's not related to microaneurysm, whereas it's related to diffuse incompetence of retinal capillaries, which is called a diffuse leak. Why we need to differentiate is that focal leak is treated with targeted photocoagulation of the leaking microaneurysm, whereas diffuse leak is treated with a macular grid laser. So when we decide that we have to do a focal laser, we have to identify the leaky aneurysm and we have to see its relation to foveal avascular zone, which again is very well characterized by fluorescein angiography. Here we can see that these are the leaky aneurysm, whereas these are the non-leaky aneurysms. By treating this non-leaky aneurysm, we are not really going to achieve anything important or anything great. So we usually don't treat any non-leaky microaneurysm, whereas a leaky aneurysm is treated and we should always make sure that it's quite away from foveal vascular zone. By typical description, it said that 500 micron from the center of fovea, we usually don't laser. Within 500 micron from the center of fovea, we usually don't laser. For example, here it's a leaky microaneurysm, but it is very close to the fovea, so we cannot do laser. Whereas this area, we can see that there is leaky microaneurysm and is leading to a focal leak, and it is away from foveal vascular zone, so we can do a laser. The other indication would be a suspicious NVE. In this color photo, we can see that there is a red lesion over here, and when we do a fluorescein angiography, it confirms the presence of neovascularization here and here. So in cases with suspicious NVE, fluorescein angiography is helpful. The other indication would be asymmetric diabetic retinopathy. For example, like one eye has a less severe form of diabetic retinopathy, say a moderate non-proliferative diabetic retinopathy, and another eye has high-risk proliferative diabetic retinopathy. This kind of a scenario can occur, and it is documented to be around 5% of patients with diabetic retinopathy. But the first thing is we should confirm whether it's definitely asymmetric. For example, in the eye which we are assuming to be a less severe eye, for example, we have diagnosed it as a moderate non-proliferative diabetic retinopathy, fluorescein angiography may reveal a presence of neovascularization, or it can show extensive non-perfusion areas, which says that the disease is actually not less severe and it is not actually an asymmetry. The other possibility is that in more severe eye, the fluorescein angiography may identify an additional component of ocular ischemic syndrome or a retinal vein occlusion, which would be the reason for a more severe form of diabetic retinopathy in this particular eye. So astroid halosis, usually the fundus will not be very clearly visible, and astroid halosis is a definite indication for fluorescein angiography. It's not specific for diabetic retinopathy. Any retinal disorder or choroidal disorder which we are suspecting but we are not able to see clearly due to astroid halosis, we can use fluorescein angiography to get the retinal and choroidal details clearly. For example, here we can see that this is the color photo which hardly shows any retinal details, but when we do a fluorescein angiography, we can see that the blood, the new vessels are seen so clearly and other features of diabetic retinopathy are seen. Why this advantage? So normally what happens is when we use an indirect ophthalmoscope, we are illuminating the eye with white light, and the astroid halosis will scatter much of the light, and the scattered light travels back into your eye, which is responsible for the blur. Whereas in fluorescein angiography, we incident the eye with a blue light. The blue light is scattered by the astroid halosis, and the scattered light, when it returns back to the fundus camera, it will be blocked by the green filter. So whatever the light which is scattered from astroid halosis is cut off from reaching the fundus camera. So the visibility of the fundus is way better when compared to visibility through an indirect ophthalmoscope. So astroid halosis and any doubtful retinal pathology, fluorescein angiography is the best modality to identify the retinal details. The other indication would be to differentiate macular edema secondary to Irwin-Gas syndrome and diabetic macular edema. This scenario usually arises when a patient with diabetic retinopathy underwent cataract surgery, and post cataract surgery he has a macular edema. We are not sure whether it is due to diabetic macular edema or due to Ehlers-Danlos syndrome. So in such cases, fluorescein angiography will help us. For example, in both the cases, we can see that there is cystoid macular edema, but here we can see that the optic disc shows only disc staining, whereas the center of the optic disc doesn't show any hyperfluorescence. So this is diabetic macular edema, whereas here we can see that the disc shows hyperfluorescence in late phase, which is called hot disc. This is mainly because in cases with Ehlers-Danlos syndrome, it's due to a low-grade inflammation in the eye. The low-grade inflammation will lead to retinal vascular incompetence, that is the capillary incompetence, which is responsible for CME. At the same time, it also leads to incompetence of the disc vessel. So the disc also shows leak. So presence of a hot disc goes in favor of Ehlers-Danlos syndrome, whereas absence goes in favor of a diabetic macular edema. So this is the list of indications and clinical utility of fluorescein angiography in diabetic retinopathy. So I'm stressing more about diabetic retinopathy because this is one of the diseases which we come across in our day-to-day practice. So coming to vein occlusions. So here we can see that this is a case of central retinal vein occlusion with extensive retinal hemorrhages. The fluorescein angiography just shows extensive hypofluorescence due to pre-retinal hemorrhage. We are not getting any adequate additional information by doing a fluorescein angiography. So fluorescein angiography is better avoided in cases of vein occlusion until the resolution of hemorrhages, because we will not get any useful information by doing a fluorescein angiography. But whereas coming to this case, it was a case of central retinal vein occlusion, which was treated with multiple anti-VEGF injections. And now we can see that there are hardly any features of central retinal vein occlusion, whereas you can see that there is cystoid macular edema. So when we do a fluorescein angiography, we can see that there is minimal disruption of foveal vascular zone. We see multiple microaneurysms in the AV phase. And in the late phase, we can see that there is a significant increase in size and intensity of hyperfluorescence, suggestive of leak in a petaloid fashion, suggestive of cystoid macular edema. So this is we hardly see any cases of any areas of hypofluorescence other than this. So this is a case of non-ischemic central retinal vein occlusion with cystoid macular edema. Whereas in this slide, we can see that there is an evidence of old central retinal vein occlusion characterized by the presence of dilated tortuous vein. And here we can see on fundus fluorescein angiography. Just give me a moment. Sorry for the interruption. We'll get back. Sorry for the interruption. So in this slide, as I was discussing, in fundus fluorescein angiography, we can see that the foveal vascular zone is significantly enlarged and distorted, suggestive of macular ischemia. Here we can see multiple areas of hypofluorescence. This hypofluorescence is due to non-perfusion, and we can see that there is presence of an irregular network of vessel over here, which is showing increase in size and intensity over time, which is suggestive of a neovascularization at disc. So this is a case of ischemic central retinal vein occlusion with neovascularization at disc. In this photograph, we can see that there is a delay in venous filling in the superior half of the retina. Here we can see that the inferior half is showing a laminar flow, whereas the superior half doesn't show any filling in the retinal veins, both the superonasal and the superotemporal vein. So which is suggestive of a superior hemiretinal vein occlusion. In this case, we can also see that there is presence of hypofluorescence here due to block fluorescence from retinal hemorrhage, whereas here due to non-perfusion. And here again, we can see that there is enlargement of foveal vascular zone, suggestive of macular ischemia. And here we can see that there are tiny areas of hyperfluorescence, which is suggestive of microaneurysm, which indicates that there would be an additional component of diabetic retinopathy. So this is a case of a possible diabetic retinopathy with superior hemiretinal vein occlusion with macular ischemia. There is no evidence of any neovascularization elsewhere or at the disc. In this photograph, we can see that there is enlargement of foveal avascular zone suggestive of macular ischemia, and we see that there are areas of capillary non-perfusion, microaneurysm, and telangiectatic vessels which are communicating the retinal vessels, and all the features are confined to the superotemporal quadrant, which is suggestive of a old superotemporal branch retinal vein occlusion with macular ischemia. A old vein occlusion usually shows presence of microaneurysms, telangiectatic communicating vessels, and capillary non-perfusion areas, and also may show staining of vessel wall. So the indications for fluorescein angiography in central retinal vein occlusion would be to document. Second would be to differentiate an ischemic and a non-ischemic central retinal vein occlusion, as we saw in a few photographs. Why we need to differentiate is that a non-ischemic CRVO is associated with poor prognosis in terms of visual acuity improvement, and also has a higher risk of development of neovascularization and would need a continuous follow-up. And the other indication would be to identification of a subtle NVD which may be missed on clinical examination. The indications in branch retinal vein occlusion, hemiretinal vein occlusion, and macular vein occlusion would be, again, one is for the documentation purpose. The other would be to identify a subtle NVD or an NVE. Here we can see that there is a sclerosed vessel in the superotemporal quadrant, but we are not seeing any specific new vessels on clinical photograph. But if we do a fluorescein angiography, we can identify a few neovascularization. So it confirms the presence of neovascularization. That's one thing. The other thing is, whenever we see a neovascularization in a vein occlusion, the next step is we proceed with laser photocoagulation. Fluorescein angiography identifies the non-perfusion areas, and we have to selectively laser this non-perfusion areas to achieve better regression of neovascularization. So that's one of the major indications for fluorescein angiography. The other indication would be to identify a subtle macular vein occlusion. Here, the color photograph would show that there is a bending of retinal vessels here and here, but we are not sure what is the definite cause. But when we do a fluorescein angiography, we can see presence of microaneurysms, telangiectatic communicating vessels restricted to one particular sector of macula, which is suggestive of a macular vein occlusion. So coming to choroidal neovascular membrane, a lesion due to a choroidal neovascular membrane is usually divided to have three lesion components. That is, a choroidal neovascular membrane itself, an hemorrhage secondary to choroidal neovascular membrane, and a scar So if we see that this lesion has more than 50% of CNV, it's called predominantly CNV. Similarly, if we see more than 50% of this lesion to be scar, we call it predominantly scar. And if we see 50% of hemorrhage is 50% of the lesion is due to hemorrhage, we call it predominantly hemorrhage. Again, choroidal neovascular membrane itself is classified as classic choroidal neovascular membrane and occult choroidal neovascular membrane based on fluorescein angiography. This is a fluorescein angiography classification. This is not same as the OCT based classification that we discuss. So classic CNV, the neovascular membrane is usually located in the subretinal space. So we can see the lesion very well on angiography. Whereas in occult CNV, it is located mainly in the sub-RPE space. So the lesion is not seen very well. Occult CNV again is classified as fibrovascular PED and late leakage of undetermined source. There is a typing error here. So again, based on the type of CNV, if the CNV is more than 50% classic, we call it predominantly classic. Whereas if it's less than 50%, but still there is some evidence of a classic CNV, call it minimally classic. Whereas if there is no evidence of a classic CNV and it's only occult, we call occult CNV with no classic. So coming to this photograph, here we can see that in the arterial phase, we can see that there is a well-defined discrete focal hyperfluorescence in the choroidal phase. Here we can see. And in the late phase, we see that there is a leak. So this is suggestive of a classic choroidal neovascular membrane. Here we can also see that there is hypofluorescence due to subretinal hemorrhage. So this is a predominantly CNV and predominantly classic, because here more than 50% of the lesion is CNV. The other part of the lesion is hemorrhage. There is no scar and the entire CNV is predominantly classic because we can see a definite vascular network in the early phase. That is in the typically it should be seen in the choroidal phase. This is one more example where we can see a cartwheel appearance. So this is again a classic CNV, but there is usually described that visibility of a vascular network is not an essential criteria to come to a diagnosis of classic CNV. If we see a definite focal hyperfluorescence in the choroidal phase itself is suggestive of classic CNV. There is no need that there should be a visible vascular network to come to a diagnosis of classic CNV. Coming to occult CNV, as I already discussed, there are two types. One is fibrovascular PED and another is late leakage of undetermined source. Coming to fibrovascular PED, here we can see that there is a hypofluorescence due to subretinal hemorrhage. And here we don't see a definite vascular network or hyperfluorescence even in the late venous frame. Whereas we can see a stippled hyperfluorescence at 1 to 2 minutes and cooling off dye in the late phase, that is increase in intensity of hyperfluorescence and the size remains constant. So this is suggestive of a fibrovascular PED. Here we can also see staining of drusen. In AMD, the drusen is seen as staining in fluorescein angiography. Not all drusen shows staining. Drusen which is predominantly filled with a hydrophilic material shows staining, whereas those which are predominantly filled with lipophilic material doesn't show staining. So it's not compulsory for all the drusen to show staining. So in this case, it's again predominantly CNV, but it is occult with no classic because there is no evidence of a classic CNV in this. In this slide, we can see that here, this particular area, if you concentrate on this particular area, we see that there is a stippled hyperfluorescence at 1 to 2 minutes, and it's showing an increase in size and intensity of the lesion in late phase, which is suggestive of a leak. Again, it's a fibrovascular PED. But fibrovascular PED can be seen as just a pooling if the neurosensory detachment is overlaying the PED and it is not extending beyond the margins. Whereas if the neurosensory detachment is extending beyond the margins of pigment epithelial detachment, it will be seen as leak. So in fibrovascular PED, the diagnosis is mainly based on a stippled hyperfluorescence at 1 to 2 minutes, whereas it may show leak or it may show pooling in late phase. So coming to late leakage of undetermined source, in this photograph, we can see that there is no evidence of a classic CNP. We are not even seeing any definite fibrovascular PED, but in the late phase, we can see that there is a significant leak in the peripheral areas, and this cannot be attributable to any specific source. So it is called late leakage of undetermined source. So the indications of fluorescein angiography in the case of choroidal neovascular membrane would be: one is to document and confirm the diagnosis. Earlier, any case of choroidal neovascular membrane, people would prefer to do a fluorescein angiography before proceeding with treatment, but nowadays the trend is decreasing. The other indication would be, we can classify the lesion as predominantly CNV or predominantly scar or predominantly hemorrhage based on fluorescein angiography. We can classify a choroidal neovascular membrane into classic and occult based on fluorescein angiography. The main reason being this being important is that PCV is seen angiographically as an occult CNV, whereas it behaves differently in terms of prognosis and response to treatment. So in case of occult CNV, it would be better to subject the patients to ICG to rule out presence of PCV. To assess the activity of choroidal neovascular membrane, for example, we are treating a patient of choroidal neovascular membrane with anti-VEGF agents, and post therapy we have to see whether it's still active or not. That's one reason where we need to do a fluorescein angiography. This is particularly done in recent times only for research purposes. The other would be to confirm the diagnosis of CNV in doubtful cases. For example, in this case, she's a myopic and she presented with sudden onset central scotoma in her left eye. Here we can see that there is subretinal hemorrhage. OCT also showed presence of a subretinal hyperreflective material, but we could not establish whether it's due to CNV, because in myopia, subretinal hemorrhage can occur either due to a break in Bruch's membrane, it's called Lacker's crack, or it can be due to a CNV. In such scenario, if we do a fluorescein angiography, here as we can see that it definitely delineates the presence of a neovascular network which leaks in late phase and confirms the diagnosis of choroidal neovascular membrane, and we may proceed with an anti-VEGF therapy. If there was no evidence of choroidal neovascular membrane on fluorescein angiography, we would have just observed the patient. Coming to the next disease, that is central serous chorioretinopathy. Central serous chorioretinopathy is a disorder characterized by the presence of subretinal fluid. So the features what we see in central serous chorioretinopathy includes: one is pooling. Here we can see that there is an area of hyperfluorescence which is increasing in size, whereas the size is same, and corresponding color photo shows presence of an orange well-defined lesion, which is suggestive of a serous PED, which is showing pooling. Whereas here we can see that there is a tiny dot hyperfluorescence which showed an increase in intensity and size in the late phase, which is suggestive of a leak. This pattern of leak is called ink blot pattern of leak. Whereas in this photograph, we can see that the leak is spreading vertically in a linear fashion initially. Here you can see it's spreading vertically in a linear fashion, whereas in the later frames, it spreads in a shape of smoke, which is called a smokestack pattern of leak, which is also seen in CSCR, and it is less common kind of a leak, and it is seen in around 10 to 15% of cases. In this case here, we can also see that there is a cooling off dye. Here, if you carefully see, you can see that there is a cooling off dye over here, which is characterized by increase in intensity of hyperfluorescence, whereas the size is almost same, which is due to a neurosensory detachment. The smokestack leak is commonly seen in the first episode and in acute cases of CSC only. The reason behind smokestack leak is postulated to be due to differential osmotic pressure of fluorescent dye and subretinal fluid. That is, some people claim that the subretinal fluid would be protein rich, because of which the dye would initially ascend up before showing a smokestack kind of a pattern. Some people claim that it may also be due to a RPE microarray, though the exact pathogenesis is not well known. Coming to chronic CSCR, here we can see that there is presence of window defect, because here we can see that the size of the hyperfluorescence is constant, whereas the intensity initially increased, later it decreased. So it is suggestive of a window defect. The window defect, which is in this particular shape, is called a gravitational tract, or also called as teardrop sign. In some cases, these areas may also show pooling. Some areas of retinal pigment hypertrophy or hyperplasia can be seen in CSC, which would be seen as block fluorescence. So the indication of fluorescein angiography in central serous chorioretinopathy would be, one is to confirm the diagnosis in atypical cases, for example, in cases with presence of fibrin in chronic CSC and multifocal CSC. The second would be to identify leak if you are planning for treatment, because we have to identify leak and we have to identify its relative location with respect to foveal avascular zone. For example, in this case, we know that this is the point of leak and it is quite away from fovea. So we can plan a laser photocoagulation to this particular area to cause regression of this leak. Whereas if it was in the subfoveal area or very close to the fovea, then we cannot do a focal laser photocoagulation and we may have to consider a photodynamic therapy. Coming to another disease, perifoveal telangiectasia. It's a degenerative retinal disorder in which there will be a perifoveal telangiectatic vessels associated with gradual degeneration and destruction of the retinal tissue. So the characteristic fluorescein angiographic features include perifoveal telangiectatic vessel, as you can see over here, and it also confirms presence of the right angled bending of vessel. That is, here we can see that this vessel is coming and it is abruptly ending. That means the vessel has taken a right angled bend into the substance of retina. So in the late phase, it can also show leak. These cases can develop choroidal neovascular membrane. So fluorescein angiography helps in confirmation of diagnosis of PFT and also may help in identification of choroidal neovascular membrane. Coats disease. Coats disease is a disease predominantly seen in young male, which is characterized by presence of telangiectatic vessels in the periphery with extensive leak of subretinal exudates, hard exudate. So fluorescein angiography would show presence of telangiectasia aneurysm, which is typically described as light bulb appearance, peripheral capillary non-perfusion areas, vascular communicating channels, and profuse leak. Wide field fluorescein angiography is more useful in identifying Coats disease, because the disease usually tends to be located in the periphery. Coming to papilledema. In papilledema, in the early phase, we see dilatation of pre-papillary and peripapillary capillaries, and in the late phase, we see a profuse leak. The advantage of using a fluorescein angiography in cases of papilledema would be that it will be helpful in differentiating a pseudopapilledema and papilledema. Papilledema would show presence of leak in late phase, whereas pseudopapilledema may not show any definite leakage. Ischemic optic neuropathy. In ischemic optic neuropathy, when we do a fluorescein angiography, we can see that please everyone mute the mic. please. Yeah. In ischemic optic neuropathy, we can see that there is hyperperfusion of disc vessels and usually an associated hyperperfusion of choroid in the corresponding sector, because it's due to blockage of one of the short ciliary vessels. So whatever sector of disc that's involved also shows a corresponding loss of circulation in the choroid. It's usually not required in diagnosis of all the cases, but in some cases where ischemic optic neuropathy shows a hyperemic disc, it would be sometimes difficult to distinguish from papillitis. In such cases, we can do a fluorescein angiography, wherein papillitis will show hyperfluorescence with leakage from the disc, whereas ischemic optic neuropathy shows non-perfusion at the disc and corresponding choroid. Coming to the inflammatory disorders of the retina and choroid. So first I will be discussing acute posterior multifocal placoid pigment epitheliopathy. It's called APMPPE. APMPPE is characterized by presence of early hypofluorescence and late staining. We can also see pooling of dye due to neurosensory detachment. We can also see hot disc, that is disc leak. So here the initial hypofluorescence is assumed to be due to choriocapillary ischemia. When coming to white dot syndromes, except multiple evanescent white dot syndrome, all the other white dot syndrome usually show early hypofluorescence with late staining, whereas in mutes we see early and late hyperfluorescence in a brick-like appearance. So the indication of fluorescein angiography in white dot syndrome would be: one is to confirm the diagnosis of white dot syndrome, and second would be some of the white dot syndromes may develop CNV and it can be confirmed by a fluorescein angiography. Coming to VKH syndrome, in VKH syndrome, early phase show multiple hypofluorescence dots, and in the late phase we see, and soon after initial hypofluorescent dots, we see multiple hyperfluorescent dots and the leak in late phase. We also see pooling of dye in neurosensory detachment. This particular image, I didn't had an early phase image, so I have just taken another image which shows presence of hypofluorescent dots in early phase of VKH. Coming to vasculitis, in active vasculitis, we see the perivascular leak, as we can see over here. Here, when compared to the earlier frame, the late frame, we can see that there is perivascular leak of dye. So in cases of active vasculitis, fluorescein angiography helps in confirmation of activity. That is, only the active phase shows a definite perivascular leak. Whereas in the case of resolved vasculitis or in a stage of ischemia or neovascularization, what we can see is we can identify presence of neovascularization at the disc, neovascularization elsewhere. We can also identify the non-perfusion areas. So the clinical utility is that in a case of vasculitis, we are not sure like which particular blood vessel is blocked. So we can identify non-perfusion areas based on fluorescein angiography, and we can specifically laser these non-perfusion areas by laser photocoagulation so that we can achieve adequate regression of NVE or an NVD. Coming to retinal and choroidal vascular tumors, initially I will be discussing retinal capillary hemangioblastoma, which is commonly seen with the VHL disease, Van Hippel-Lindau. So this is a solitary retinal capillary hemangioblastoma. It shows an intense hyperfluorescence in the early phase as it is completely composed of blood vessels, and in the late stage we can see either leak or staining. The clinical utility of fluorescein angiography in retinal capillary hemangioblastoma is that, as in this image we can see that these two lesions we are seeing very clearly, but in fluorescein angiography other than these two lesions we also see a small lesion which was missed on color photograph. So the clinical utility of color fluorescein angiography in cases with VHL is that if we see one or two lesions, we should proceed with a fluorescein angiography to identify smaller lesions which are missed on color photograph. Identifying a smaller lesion is important as it is important to laser them at an earlier stage so that they will not lead to a rapid increase in size, which would be difficult to treat later. So this is a cavernous hemangioma of retina, which is typically described as presence of a grape-like cluster. The fluorescein angiographic picture is characteristic in this particular tumor. We see fluorescein caps. That is, here we can see that we can see that the top of each grape-like lesion shows a hyperfluorescence, which is called fluorescein cap. This is mainly because the RBCs and the RBCs, the WBCs, settle in the lower half of the grape-like cluster, whereas the plasma floats in the superior half, so that it is seen as a fluorescein cap. So though this is definitely suggestive of cavernous hemangioma, in subtle cases it would be difficult. For example, in this case is an atypical case of cavernous hemangioma where there is a pre-retinal and subretinal hemorrhage. In such cases, fluorescein angiography can identify fluorescein cap and confirm the diagnosis of cavernous hemangioma in such cases. This is vasoproliferative tumor of retina. Here, this is an yellow-white lesion, which is vascular, and it shows profuse leak on fluorescein angiography. Choroidal hemangioma. Choroidal hemangioma shows hyperfluorescence in the early phase, whereas in the late phase, it shows increase in intensity, mainly appearing as staining. We can also see pooling of dye in cases with neurosensory detachment secondary to exudative RD. Choroidal melanoma. In fluorescein angiography demonstrates intrinsic vasculature of choroidal melanoma. So choroidal melanoma fluorescein angiography characteristic is a dual circulation. That is, we can see the circulation of retinal vessels overlaying the tumor. We can also see intrinsic tumor vasculature. It would be essential to do a fluorescein angiography in suspected cases of melanoma to differentiate it from other choroidal tumors. So to summarize, it's always better to use a specific angiographic terms, interpret each lesion before reaching a conclusion. For example, in the case of diabetic retinopathy, it's not a single lesion. We see a multiple lesions. Interpret each lesion separately before coming to a conclusion. And always an imaging modality should be interpreted with a background clinical information. I know that it's a very vast topic, so I have just touched a few important diseases, and particularly I have not focused on the technique of performing an angiography, what are the side effects of fluorescein angiography, the sodium fluorescein that we use, all those things haven't discussed, kindly go through. I would like to thank all my mentors and all my colleagues from Shankarai Hospital for providing me with so much of input and images for preparing this presentation. I would like to take some of the questions. There's a question from Dr. Devashish. How to differentiate physiological distaining from pathological staining is what he has asked. The physiological distaining usually is localized to lamina cribrosa and the margins of optic disc. In cases with peripapillary crescent, the crescent also shows a staining. In absence of these, if we see that there is an excess hyperfluorescence, it would be possibly pathological and we call it disc leak. I think got the answer. The next question is how to differentiate between dot hemorrhage and microaneurysm in fluorescein angiography. It's a question by Dr. Anand Singhi. So microaneurysm is derived from retinal capillaries. So it contains fluorescein and it is seen as hyperfluorescence, whereas a dot hemorrhage is seen as an area of blocked fluorescence because it doesn't contain any fluorescein. Rather, it would be blocking the underlying fluorescence. So a dot hemorrhage is seen as hypofluorescence, whereas microaneurysm is seen as hyperfluorescence. There's a question by Dr. Devashish Dubey who is asking like differentiating features of diabetic papillopathy from optic neuropathy. I'm not very sure like what the question is, like is it a difference between diabetic papillopathy and ischemic optic neuropathy, or like what exactly are expecting? Kindly clarify. There's a question by Dr. Preeti Jain. Can we do FA in a patient with chronic renal failure with less concentration of fluorescein? See, the problem with chronic kidney disease is that we are worried about contrast-induced nephropathy. Contrast-induced nephropathy is quite common when CT, or a computed tomography with contrast is done, or a patient undergoes coronary angiography, whereas it is less commonly reported with fluorescein angiography. For example, like in a series of around 180 patients, 2% of the patients with chronic renal failure showed an increase in serum creatinine, which resolved itself at 10 days. There is no evidence to say that doing a fluorescein angiography is harmful in chronic kidney disease. But in clinical practice, most of us retinal physicians defer doing fluorescein angiography unless it is specifically warranted. Particularly, some people choose to do a fluorescein angiography on a day before dialysis, or on the day like just before dialysis, so that whatever dye we have injected can be washed away with dialysis. And some people prefer to use a lesser concentration of fluorescein. Instead of 3 ml of 20% fluorescein, some people prefer to use just a 1.5 ml of 20% fluorescein or 25% fluorescein. So there's a question by Dr. Uday. How to differentiate fibrovascular PED with NSD from CSC? So in fibrovascular PED usually shows a stippled hyperfluorescence. It will not be a single dot. But in cases of CSC, the leak usually starts from a single point, whereas in a fibrovascular PED, it's a stippled hyperfluorescence, which would be multiple. Sometimes it would not be possible to differentiate easily. This is a question by Dr. Sriram Charan. While obtaining pictures from fundus camera, 50 degree versus 30 degree, which one is best and why, sir? See, it depends on what you are looking at. If you want a very high magnification of a particular lesion, you can use a 30 degree. For example, if you want to see a lesion and want to differentiate it, whether it's a CNV or not, you can use a 30 degree image. But usually most of the cases can be managed with 50 degree itself. Hardly few people usually take an image with 30 degree to identify any specific image. So there's another question by Dr. Anand Dayal. How to differentiate FAF and FFA? Like the question is how to differentiate a fundus autofluorescence and fundus fluorescein angiography. Fundus autofluorescence the blue wave fundus autofluorescence is mainly due to presence of lipofuscin in the retinal pigment epithelium. So wherever the retinal pigment epithelium is not seen, fundus autofluorescence is seen as hypoautofluorescence. The area of retina which is divided of retinal pigment epithelium is optic disc. So optic disc is always hypoautofluorescent in fundus autofluorescence, whereas in fundus fluorescein angiography, it will be showing hyperfluorescence due to the presence of disc vessels. So to differentiate fundus autofluorescence image and fundus fluorescein angiography, the thing you have to do is you have to see the area of retina which is divided of RPE, which is optic disc. So fundus autofluorescence shows hypoautofluorescence, whereas fundus fluorescein angiography shows hyperautofluorescence at optic disc. There are a few certain conditions which show hyperautofluorescence at optic disc, which includes optic nerve intrusion or astrocytic hamartoma. Other than that, usually fundus autofluorescence shows a dark hypoautofluorescent optic disc. There's a question by Dr. Satish. How to clinically differentiate microaneurysm and dot hemorrhage? It's not always possible to differentiate a dot hemorrhage from a microaneurysm clinically. There's a question by Dr. Anand. How to differentiate preretinal hemorrhage and subretinal hemorrhage in FFA? As I already described, the block fluorescence, there are two types. One in which both the retinal and choroidal fluorescence are blocked. That is, for example, you have a preretinal hemorrhage, you'll see it as hypofluorescence and you will not be able to see the retinal vessels and will not be able to see the choroidal fluorescence. Whereas in cases with subretinal hemorrhage, the hypofluorescence is due to presence of blood in the subretinal space. So the overlying retinal vessels will be seen normally. So in this scenario, a preretinal hemorrhage will not show presence of retinal fluorescence, whereas a subretinal hemorrhage show the overlying retinal vessels. This is a question by Dr. Tapesh. What is the appearance of optic disc on fluorescein angiography in a patient of papillitis or optic neuritis? Papillitis is usually characterized by, clinically it is characterized by presence of hyperemia, which indicates that the blood vessels are dilated and there is leak. So on fluorescein angiography of papillitis, we see that there is evidence of early phase hyperfluorescence with diffuse leak from the optic disc in cases with papillitis. Whereas in retrovalvar neuritis, we don't see any angiographic finding. There's a question by Dr. Zuhi. How to differentiate pooling of neurosensory detachment and that of PED in CSR? CSR is usually small and well-defined, whereas neurosensory detachment is usually larger. So the intensity of pooling would be higher in cases with PED, whereas it would not be that much in cases with neurosensory detachment. But if the case is that the neurosensory detachment is tiny, there is a possibility that it may show a more intense hyperfluorescence also. That in such scenario, it would be difficult to distinguish. But usually, a neurosensory detachment, the pooling appears late and it is less intense, whereas a PED shows a early pooling and it is more intense. Question by Dr. Atul. Which is the best phase to look for trap lesion or type 3 CNV? The best phase to see RAP would be, again, like it needs both, like for example, if you are dealing with a type 1 RAP, which is an intraretinal neovascularization without evidence of a CNV, in that case, we have to depend on a venous phase, that is around 20 to 25 seconds, which is the phase of highest concentration of fluorescein in the retinal and choroidal circulation. So it would be ideally a 20 to 25 minute late venous phase, which would be better.
Yes, I think that is all. I think we can see the questions. Very nice presentation, Dr. Pradeep. Very comprehensive coverage of a topic which is very extensive and very important for residents, both DNB as well as MS students. I think it'll be beneficial to all of them. Thank you very much, Dr. Pradeep.
Thank you, sir.
For tomorrow's session, we'll be having a talk on corneal degenerations and dystrophies by Dr. Pallavi, who's our cornea consultant in at Shankar Eye Hospital, Bangalore. The time remains the same, 12 to 1, and the link also remains the same. So thank you all. Thank you, Dr. Pradeep. Take care, stay safe, and see you all tomorrow. Bye.